Inkscape recently released Inkscape 1.1, its follow-up version to its major Inkscape 1.0 release, and I have to say, this is a game changer. This new release sees new features and bug fixes, but most importantly, it refines Inkscape as a vector graphics software with improvements that make the software more professional. In this tutorial, I'll be covering what's new in Inkscape 1.1. But of course, before I get into that, don't forget to check out my website at daviesmediadesign.com. I have tons of video tutorials on here, as well as free software help articles, so definitely check that out. You can get more content by becoming a DMD Premium member, and I'll include a link to this, as well as all the relevant links from this tutorial in the description of the video. All right, let's dive into what's found in this latest version. For starters, you'll want to download and install Inkscape 1.1 from the Inkscape website. After the program is installed, it now automatically pops up with a fancy looking welcome window that has you set up some of your own custom preferences. You can now change the color and style of your canvas, change the shortcut keys, including matching those of other programs you may be used to, including Illustrator or Corel Draw, and change the styling of the UI or your tool icons. There is also now a toggle that allows you to turn on or off the dark mode for your UI. You'll also notice here that the graphics at the top of the welcome window contain artwork. This artwork was submitted during Inkscape's About Screen contest, with the works displayed here being the runners-up from the contest. The winner of the contest, Fauzan Sayukri, has their artwork displayed on the main About screen, as well as on the last tab of the welcome screen, which we'll get into here momentarily. Once you click save, you'll then be taken to the second tab of the welcome window. There are three tabs total. Here, you're given information about how you can contribute to Inkscape, either by helping develop the program or by donating money. Clicking any of the links here will take you to the respective pages on the Inkscape website to tell you more about contributing. Moving on to the final page of the welcome screen, which is probably my favorite, Inkscape now allows you to open a recent document or create a new document based on any of the templates listed here. The template interface is nice and neat, allowing you to scroll through the various documents, which are labeled with a descriptive title as well as their dimensions. And there is also a series of tabs on the left side with different categories of templates. Inkscape's templates include commonly used dimensions for print, digital screens, video, social, and other, which appears to mostly contain templates for designing Inkscape assets. Some useful templates you'll find in here include templates for business cards, legal documents, 4K video, Snapchat ads, and social posts. When you're ready to open a template, double-click on it and it'll open it into Inkscape as a new document. One downside I'll mention to this new templates feature is that it only appears to be available via the welcome screen when you first install Inkscape or when you open Inkscape for a new session. In other words, when I go to File New, it simply creates a new document using the default dimensions rather than popping up with this new template or new document window. I personally think in future versions of Inkscape, going to File New should take you to the template window. However, when you close down Inkscape and reopen it, the new welcome screen does appear, and you can also disable this feature using the little checkbox in the bottom left corner if you prefer the old startup method. The next new feature I want to highlight, which is yet another feature I'm really excited about, is Inkscape's new command palette feature. Similar to GIMP's search actions feature, this feature allows you to search commands in Inkscape rather than always having to go through the app's menus to find what you're looking for. To access this feature, hit Shift plus the forward slash key on your keyboard, or in other words, the question mark key, and the command dialog, or command palette as Inkscape is referring to it, will pop up. By default, this dialog has a list of potential actions you can use in the program, which I think is a nice touch. You can scroll through the actions with your mouse to get some ideas of what to type, or simply type the action you'd like to use in the search bar. A common action you can use, for example, is converting objects to paths. You can exit this command palette using the escape key on your keyboard. Next up is the new Dockable Dialogues functionality. This feature applies to the dialogues that typically pop up on the right-hand side of your canvas when activated, and include dialogues like align and distribute, text and font, fill and stroke, layers, and more. The old behavior of these dialogues was that when you had multiple dialogues open, they would stack vertically, with the topmost dialog being the active dialog. So when you clicked on a new dialog tab somewhere in the stack, that dialog would then get moved to the top of the stack and would display all of its options. Now the Dockable dialogs stack horizontally as tabs, and you can click on any of the tabs to make that dialog active. The active tab will display its options in the Dockable dialog area, while the inactive tabs simply display the icon for that dialog in their respective tab. Plus, you can drag dialogs so that they now stack in separate rows, with the active dialog from each row displaying its options. This is more similar to how dialogs display in other design software, including GIMP, so I think users will find this setup more intuitive and user-friendly. Additionally, the dialogs can now be moved to new locations around the canvas. They no longer simply reside on the right side. They can also be moved over to the left side of the canvas by clicking and dragging them to the highlighted areas, releasing your mouse when you're ready to place them. This allows you to have the dialogues on either side of the canvas or to move all the dialogues to the left side. The main downside to this setup is that you can't really shrink the dialog sizes down too much. So when you have dialogues on both sides of the canvas window itself can become quite cramped or small. Additionally, the actual area where you have to drag your mouse in order to get the little highlight line to show up to release the dialog is pretty small. So sometimes it can be tricky locating the exact area before you release. All that being said, I do like the new tab setup much better than the previous vertical stacking arrangement, and I do think this new layout has a lot of potential for future iterations of Inkscape. I'll also note that the F12 key hides all the dialogues and also brings them back, which is a handy shortcut. Moving on to the next new feature, the preferences dialog now has a search bar that allows you to quickly find any preference you're looking for. For example, if I wanted to change the style of my icons, I can type icons here, and it'll only display the preferences that have the keyword icons listed in the options. Also, all the areas that contain the search term will be highlighted, allowing you to quickly find the settings you're looking for. A new outline overlay mode makes its way into Inkscape 1.1, allowing you to preview your work with outlines of your paths and shapes, along with a slightly transparent preview of your full colored artwork below. You can access this new mode by going to View, Display Mode, Outline Overlay. To go back to the default display mode, simply go to View, Display Mode, Normal. Several updates have been made to various painting, drawing, and node tools in Inkscape 1.1, including improvements to the calligraphy tool to make it more precise. I'll admit this is not a tool I use that often, but essentially the tool now supports units for the width of the line drawn, and also has measurement precision up to 3 decimal places. So the strokes created by this tool should now be versatile based on width, and the size of the strokes should be more precise to your settings. The connector tool, which is used to connect objects on your composition using lines and is most useful or most commonly used in technical diagrams, received an update where the lines drawn between objects now update in real time as you move objects they are connected to. Additionally, an update was made to the tool based on a bug report that allows objects to be connected even when objects are stacked on top of one another. Martin Owens, who is essentially the lead contributor to Inkscape, introduced in Inkscape 1.1 the ability to copy nodes from a section of a path using the node tool and paste them as a new shape. To use this new feature, draw a shape, for example, convert the object to a path, then use the node tool to select the nodes you want to copy. Deselect the original shape by double-clicking off it. Then paste the nodes on your composition. A new shape will be created from the nodes you've selected. Keep in mind that if you don't deselect the original shape before pasting your nodes, the new shape will automatically be tied to the original shape. So any movements, transformations, or restyling of the original shape will also occur to the new shape. Next up, there have been some new and exciting additions made to the live path effects in Inkscape 1.1. The first is the introduction of the Slice Live Path effect. This new feature allows you to slice any shape into 2 pieces while still maintaining the original shape. To use this effect, draw any shape, then with the shape active, go to Path, Path Effects, click the little plus icon to add a new effect, and select Slice. By default, your shape will now be sliced down the middle. However, you can grab the Nodes tool and click on the middle node of the line where the slicing is occurring. When you drag the node, the location of the slice will change in real time. Releasing your mouse sets the new location of the slice, and you can now drag the two shapes on either side of the slice using the Select tool. You can add another instance of the slice effect to the newly sliced shapes to slice the shape again. Plus, you can rotate the top or bottom node of the slice line using the Nodes tool to change the direction of the slice. Again, when you release your mouse, the slice will be applied, and you can move either shape using the Select tool. If you click on the shape that has the slice effect and remove the effect from the Live Path Effects dialog, the original shape will be restored. So this is a great non-destructive way to create slices from your shapes. The next new Live Path effect added in Inkscape 1.1 is the new Boolean Operation LPE, which was available as an experimental LPE in Inkscape 1.0, but has now been moved to the main Live Path Effects dialog with all the other stable Live Path effects. This feature allows you to essentially build shapes using two paths or objects. To use the effect, draw two shapes, for example, then click on one of the shapes and copy it to your clipboard by hitting Ctrl C. Click on the other shape and add the Boolean operation LPE by clicking the plus icon in the Live Path Effects dialog and choosing Boolean operation. Choose an operation from the settings, then click the little clipboard icon to perform the operation using the shape you copied earlier. This is another great way to perform non-destructive effects on your shapes and paths in Inkscape. Additional updates or improvements have been made to the Fill Between Many, Offset, and Taper Stroke Live Path effects in Inkscape 1.1. Moving on, Inkscape 1.1 now comes with a much improved export dialog. For starters, exporting now occurs when you click Save after renaming your document, which is a much needed change from the previous setup where you had to rename your document, click Save, and then click Export again. Anyone who's experienced this process knows just how redundant and frustrating it could be, so I'm glad to finally see it fixed. Plus, Inkscape now lets you export to other formats besides PNG, including JPEG, TIFF, and WebP files. Exporting to JPEGs is huge in my opinion, as it can help people exporting their works for the web, for example, without needing to import PNG files into another program like GIMP for conversion to a JPEG. I have no idea what took Inkscape so long to implement this feature, but it's here now, so that's exciting. When you do export to JPEG, you'll get a message letting you know that you've made a terrible mistake and should consider another file format like PNG or WebP instead to preserve your masterpieces. The dialog even provides a link to a diatribe on the Inkscape website that delves more into why JPEG is the devil. Though it is true that you'll lose quality when exporting to JPEG, sometimes you just need that option. But regardless, I do appreciate the educational information on why certain formats are better for vector artwork. It should be noted that there are actually two tabs for the JPEG dialog, with the second tab allowing you to choose the quality of your JPEG and check or uncheck the progressive format option, which has to do with how your image will load on the web. Click OK to export the JPEG, and somewhere in the universe, an Inkscape developer will wince like Voldemort after one of his Horcruxes was destroyed. Each of the other export file types have their own dialog as well, including the PNG dialog, which now allows you to optimize your PNG. Finally, the last thing I want to note about Inkscape 1.1 is that a beta version of a new Extensions Manager feature has been rolled out. This feature, which is also currently being tested for GIMP, will allow users to quickly access and install Inkscape-approved Python extensions and plugins from within the Inkscape program. This will help extend Inkscape's capabilities while also making solid plugins developed by the Inkscape community more accessible to everyone. You can access this feature by going to Extensions, Manage Extensions. You'll see three tabs here, the first being Active Extensions for extensions that are currently installed on your app, followed by Install Packages for a library of extensions you can download, and finally Create Package, which provides a link on how to create your own extensions. Under Install Packages, you'll notice there are already some extensions available to try out. Though keep in mind, this is a beta version, so they may be buggy, as may be the Extensions Manager window itself. But that's it for this tutorial. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my channel, and click the bell icon to be notified each time I have a brand new tutorial. You can check out any of the relevant links for this video in the description. But thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.